At what point, when did you start writing? You know, high school, when was the first point that you thought, I can do this? And what?
You never know that you can do it. Every time you sit down to write, it's like, it always feels like the first time. You always, I don't know. And I've talked to other writers, and it's the same kind of thing. the process of getting, cracking it, and getting inside of it, it's always, you know, contentious sort of thing. You know, you're always, you're not sure where it's going to go, or how could I ever write The Will Survive? How could I ever write One Time, One Night again? You know, because you can't put it together from the outside. You got to get back inside in order to do it.
All right. So at some point early on, you were like, you're going to make something happen. And you know, thinking back then, it was just sort of, I'm young, I'm going to write a song. Right.
Oh, going back to the early days.
Yeah, it's just like the early days. Like,
well, let's see.
Was there a song you heard? Or?
Yeah, of course. I think I grew up in East LA, so we had R&B and Mexican music around all the time, and so it was always around me, and I always heard it. I think for me as a songwriter, what first it was probably the Birds, like Mr. Tambourine Man or My Back Pages or something like that. And I realized, wow, this is not just about She Broke My Heart. There was something more to it, and it was really interesting. Not to discount, I mean, Smokey Robinson probably was one of the greatest songwriters of all time. And but you know, he knew how to craft a great song. But when it had different kind of context, like the Bells Are Ringing, it was Birds that kind of, you know, turned me on to like, there's something else beyond you know, She Loved Me and Now I'm Pissed Off.
Right. And then at some point you decided, I'm going to do that too.
Well, I was always scribbling. You know, I was always writing something. I was always attracted to language. And I was listening to the way people talk. Actually, somebody even told me that I've got this habit that when I speak to somebody, even just in an informal situation. However, I'm always looking at their lips, and I never realized that. Why don't I look at their eyes? I don't look at their eyes, I'm looking at their lips. I just like see the words coming out. You know, I can see them like in 3D sometimes, you know.
Nice.
Yeah, it depends on what I'm on.
Right. No. Did he say that? We'll take that out of the video.
No, I don't do any of that stuff.
So in high school, is that probably when you first?
Probably what happened when I first started writing songs was with David. I had been fooling around with things, you know, like just scribbling little things that didn't really have anything to do with a song or anything, really. Just little chunks of things that you don't want to call it poetry or whatever you want to call it. But when I met David in high school, I met him at this art class at James A. Garfield High School, and we started talking about music, and his taste in music were as weird as mine, so we became friends. And then one I went over to his house one day for about a year.
Right.
And we played the guitars, and then the next thing was just to start writing songs. So this is probably dates back to about 1971.
Okay, so it wasn't like you were in, because a lot of bands, actually maybe a little earlier than your time, where, you know, we're going to start a band and play cover songs and do that. That really wasn't your
Nothing's
experience.
Earlier than my time. I'm an old dude.
So your experience really wasn't that, though. It was, let's just get together and play. You probably, you know, played other people's songs. Because you did do some of that, right? You were playing house parties. And
Of course, yeah. I just started a band with David, and we played backyard parties and
right.
Anything else. But we weren't learning top 40 or anything, because that was kind of like the only way. I mean, that was kind of like the holy grail, or your final destination as being a musician in East LA, is by learning how to sound exactly like the top 10 records.
Right.
And playing clubs. But what we did was we played obscure covers, obscure songs off of favorite records, and we covered those. And we did everything like Fleetwood Mac and, you know, whatever you could imagine, just off the beaten path sort of stuff.
The older Fleetwood Mac, the blues stuff and all of that.
Yeah.
So
like
then,
well.
And then at some point, you know, the originals started creeping their way in.
Yeah. Well, we kind of got sidetracked a little bit, because when the band formed in 1973, Los Lobos was, you know, our mission was to express musically the music of our heritage.
Right.
So when we discovered Mexican music, it was like, man, you're talking about, we've got this 100-year history to explore. So for the first 10 years of the band, we played regional Mexican music. We were learning how to play the instruments. And there was really no time for anything else. Plus, it was like we were intrigued by the music, that's the only thing we thought about for a while.
Okay.
You know, just we got to, you know, it's like, okay, I got a bike for Christmas.
Right.
I'm just going to ride my bike forever now. And you don't think about anything else. So we're very myopic in about this Mexican music thing. We wanted to learn how to play it. We wanted to learn how to play it well. And we brought our sensibilities as being rock and roll guys to it as well.
Okay.
So the first 10 years we didn't do anything. And then finally we made our way back to rock and roll in the late 70s. That's when songwriting kind of came back up again.
Okay, because the another band from East LA, that was like 1978.
Correct.
And that was more of the regional Mexican music. And then eventually you transition to where you get to like At a Time to Dance in 83
yeah.
or so.
Yeah.
And so at that point, now you've found a way to meld these traditions or at least combine them sonically on a record.
Yeah. We had learned all of this music, the stuff that we kind of learned by osmosis just about growing up, and all of, you know, playing Mexican music for about 10 years, you know, regional Mexican music. And of course, when I say regional Mexican music, for the most part, everybody thinks Mexican music is just, you know, mariachis, those guys with the, you know, funny hats, and, you know, there's about 12 of them.
Lots of trumpets.
But there's regional music is very specific to different parts of Mexico. The way the vocal treatment, the instrumentation, everything's it's completely different. From Jalisco to Veracruz, it's like completely different. So we had a lot of stuff. We were busy.
Right.
We had a lot of stuff to do.
And what else were you doing during that time? Working, you know, working during the day, you know, school, all of that.
Well, I'm one of the very fortunate people who could. I don't know if I can proudly say that I never had a real job. You know.
You can proudly say that. I think so.
I never did. I always kind of played music. And when the band formed in 73, see, I got married in like 75, and the kids happened. But it was always the band was really important to us, and I think our spouses, our wives, they supported that, and I think they recognized something in this band that was just a little bit different, and kind of, I did use magical or special or anything like that. It was just that there was something about it that needed to be supported, and we did. I mean, you know, there was times when it was rough because that's all we did.
Right.
You know, we had to depend on a wedding or a party or something to make our dough, and if we ran short of dough or whatever, we'd have a potluck, and everybody would get fed, and we'd go over to somebody's house for something. And Gary remembers all those days, and we'd have yard sales, and we would, you know, we'd play at the yard sales to kind of promote stuff, you know, come, you know, buy this blender.
Right. Yeah.
It was a struggle, but it was worth it. It was something that we recognized really out that this is what we need to do, and this has to be the first and foremost thing in our lives.
I'm, you know, with the punk scene that was going on, with all, there was so much going on out of LA at that time.
Yeah.
That there was a lot of, I think, attention focused here, and I think you're right. There was a voice that needed to get out there, and so then you know you're doing the traditional regional things, and you start writing, and then At a Time to Dance won a Grammy, correct?
That's
obviously helped to help things along. And so how do you get from there to something like How Will It Survive? Is a label behind you at this point? Is you, you know?
Yeah, what happens, and I won't bore you with all those kind of particulars, but we were signed to a punk rock label that was called Slash Records.
Right.
They had enough bands that had drawn enough attention to themselves that Warner Brothers decided that, hey, we're interested. So they did a partner thing with Slash Records. They were their distribution arm, and also they had the option of picking up any band that they thought was really promising and bring them over to their label.
Okay.
So we were one of those bands that crossed over to Warner's, but it was still a Slash on the label.
Right. No, I remember again X and the Germs and other people, and some made it. Some
that's right. All of that. Some great stuff. It was the stuff that really inspired me.
Yeah. So then in terms of the craft, is it much different today than it was back then? Do you still, you know, in terms of you sit down and do you have that mindset of, okay, I'm going to write songs for an album, or I'm just going to write songs and then eventually we have enough for an album? How does that?
Okay. That never happens. As far as we only write like on demand. I mean, it's kind of, it's kind of, you know. But the fact that we're on the road constantly, there's no time. And you know, I was talking to Dave Allen last night, because he's going to write an essay for this this book on my writing and everything. It's going to be published sometime in about a year. And I talked to him and I said, Dave, can you write on the road? He goes, man, I've probably written 5 songs on the road. He says, I can, you know, and I said, I thought it was just me because as I get older, I get more compartmental. You know, the road is one thing, writing is one thing. I just can't do the multitask thing as I used to. So he said himself, again, no, I can't write on the road. So we go into the studio, and this is kind of unusual. We usually have like a few weeks to kind of get some ideas together. But for the past 3 records, we came into the studio with nothing. And there might be just one little piece of music or something. And that just starts to, it primes the kind of whole thing, and then it starts to roll. So the last record we came in with maybe just one little thing that David had come up with. Caesar had one little piece of something. And we just started tracking those ideas. And then more ideas started happening, more things started tracking, and then we'd go home and work on more, you know, like whatever. I'd work on melodies and lyrics, and then David would say, well, I've got this other idea, and then 2 months later, we got a record. So it's, I don't know how it happens, but it manages to happen somehow.
Well, and a little backstory. I've been here about 4.5 years, and I think when I came on, you guys had just done, maybe it was even the last of what you affectionately call the David Louie Show, and so I was working all over the place trying to bring this here, and hitting dead end, and thankfully, finally through a mutual friend, Louie and I were able to connect, and really this whole thing has gotten put together through 80% texts and 20% phone calls, right, where we've talked and things like that. But the fascinating thing is, as we've talked, and I think we finalized it in November, I was in San Antonio, you were on the road, and all this stuff came together. I don't think you'd even started working on the record, and you'd said, oh, we're going to start working on our record after the new year, because we were talking about this other project idea and things like that. And then the next thing I know, on Facebook, the studio that you're recording at is posting pictures, and I'm thinking of our conversations, thinking, they have not worked on anything. Like, I mean, we've been talking. How are they in the studio already when I'm talking to Louie and he's like, we don't have any, you know, yeah, we're just going to do this. So I was amazed at that, how quickly that came together. And then when you told me the other day or last week or whatever, oh yeah, we're basically done.
Yeah, we're kind of the paratroopers of songwriting. you just jump out of the plane and then somehow.
And then there's songs.
And then there's songs. I don't know how it happens.
So in terms of the group dynamic.
And a mutual friend, that's my wife wouldn't be my friend.
Well,
no,
that was...
she is my friend.
Well, Xochitl was really the...
Xochitl, okay.
Yeah, so what...
You and Mary had talked about
well,
this.
Well, yeah, here's the funny thing. Okay, so Louis's wife works here sometimes as an adjunct professor. And so, unbeknownst to anything, she came over to talk to me about putting on a Latino panel.
Oh, that's right.
And so then we started talking, and I don't know, somehow it came up, and that was then the connection of, oh my gosh. And then so I told her, I said, you have no idea, one, and I hate to do this right here, but what a big fan I am. I worked in record stores in the 80s, and, you know, I remember when And a Time to Dance came out, and especially when How Will Survive came out, and hearing that record and thinking, this is incredible. And really, probably honestly, for the first time, hearing Norteño music and giving it its fair share, which I now love a lot. But, and in fact, my wife and I, New Year's before we got married on January 5th, we saw you with X and the Pogues at the Palladium. Yeah,
that
19.
Was that was
New
wild.
Year's. Yeah.
Joe Strummer.
Joe Strummer played with the Pogues, right? Yeah. So then what happened, though, was the next semester, whatever, Mary was not on the faculty, and I didn't know this, but when they leave, the email addresses go dormant. So I lost my connection. And so I couldn't figure out why I wasn't hearing back and all this sort of stuff. And then Xochitl then put that back together.
Yeah.
So all of this, you know, coming together of this song, in terms of the group dynamic, you've all got your little bits and pieces. How much of it then in the studio is collaborative versus, you know, this is my song, and you know, how do you guys work that all out in terms of the actual writing credits and realizing the song and everything?
Yeah, well, Dave and I write together. Caesar writes on his own, and bringing kind of just like the basic kind of idea, then the whole band tracks it, does just a basic track, and then just kind of everybody goes away, and the only ones left are the songwriters. And for David and I, you know, we were in the studio for the past, you know, like 6 weeks out of the whole 2 months, working on songs, you know, getting, you know, getting a lyric done. You know, if I worked on a lyric and a melody, you know, I'd bring it into the studio and then I teach it to him, and then once we get the vocal on, then we start adding everything else to it. We reach a point in tracking just music that you can't go any further until you have a vocal.
Right. Okay.
The vocal and the lyric kind of just gives you the whole idea. It adds all of these colors to the palette. Up to that point, you're just using like three or four colors, and then suddenly you get this whole palette, and then you start adding things that support the vibe, the idea of what the song is about, whatever, you know, a big guitar solo and something that doesn't feel appropriate, you know. So it's important to have the lyrics and the vocal done before we can move on.
Okay. So when you're coming in, how many of your songs would you say you've got an idea about, hey, this is going to be a story about this? And you know, I guess I'm trying to get a little deeper into that process versus, you know, I want to write a song about, you know, X, Y, and Z, and then it materializes, or do you end up, you know, what percentages, chord progressions that start to realize, and then you go away and let the ideas gestate?
I think it's the latter. It's you take a piece of music home and then you listen and then well, I tell you, there's one thing that kind of happens. There's the song we're going to do tonight. You know, I wrote the melody and the lyric for it. But a lot of times, what David will do is he'll create the melody and he'll go in to the studio and he'll do a scratch vocal, which is basically just him kind of humming along, which creates a kind of a template so that I can work on lyric, and then I change melody around a little bit to conform with my ideas or whatever. But there's a lot of times when
the phone's on. Oh, it's his wife, it's okay.
Yeah. 5 to 6 was the top. Yeah. 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 Save me something. Okay. Okay. No. Okay. Okay. Bye. Sorry about that.
Hey, no problem.
But you know, when the phone says Mary.
Hey, you know, no, I get it. When the wife calls.
But an interesting thing happens because I'll hear him humming along, and it's not just you actually kind of kind of like gibberish kind of thing. And a lot of times I'll hear something. I'll start to hear lyrics. I'll start to hear words, because a lot of the time, most of the time when I create a lyric, I'm looking for the musicality of the word or the line. I'm looking for the music in the sound of the word, and that's so that I can create this thing where the music and the lyrics kind of meld together, so it doesn't feel like you just slapped on top of it. And that's what happens. I start to hear something. I remember one time we were in the studio, and sometimes it's just the music itself. David came in, I forget what record we were. Oh, Good Morning, Aslan. And he calls me up. He says, "I got this song." I said, "David, we're kind of done with this record." I said, "I got this song." I said, "Well, this is called Mitchell Up, and let's get down to the studio." We went down to the studio, and he played the idea, and we said, "Wow, okay." We called Pete Thomas from the Attractions, you know, and he came down, and they started tracking it, and then I was in the next room, and I heard the song starting to come together, and then I heard Good Morning, Aslan, and they became the song. That was the song that became the title track to that record. But I kind of heard it. It was just like, "Good Morning, Aslan." They said that was it. And then after that, because of that title, I created this whole thing about the typical day in a cinematographic sort of look at a morning in East LA. And that's what became Good Morning, Aslan. All right,
wow.
So it happens in all kind of different shapes and forms. But
now, do you write things like that? Do you write poetry as well as a different thing? Is that not really anything that you go into?
Well, you know, I'll tell you, I'm going to be, you know, I'm 62 years old. It's time to kind of take the gloves off and just say, you know, hey, this is just the way it is. I've always ran the other way when I heard the word poetry, because, it's so loaded. You know, being a writer is so loaded. Being an artist in general, there's so much to it. I just ran from that. To this day, I mean, I'm finally accepting the fact I'm an artist. I can actually say that.
Right.
Because there's just so much that, and I'm not saying about the cliches that go with it, but there's so much, the bar's so high. And I always felt kind of almost proletariat in my work. I once pissed off a music critic at the LA Times, and I said, I would much rather reduce the writing part to throwing a stick across a yard. And he says, "How could you say something like that?" You know, and I said, "Well, that's what I want it to be. I want it to be something that simple and that pure that it does." And I think he just got me all wrong to begin with, you know. But that's always been my thing. You know, I've always kind of had this view that anybody can do what I do. It's not necessarily like a gift. I mean, some of us have maybe a facility with words or with music, but I think largely there's a lot of factors that are involved in the reason why a lot of people aren't creative and aren't artists. And a lot of it has to do with the socioeconomic factors. You know, if you're worried about having food on the table, if you're worried about not getting yourself, you know, shot, you know, in the rough parts of the urban world, you're not gonna be thinking about wanting to learn to play saxophone or wanting to write songs. So anyway, that's my soapbox sort of thing. So that's how I kind of feel about it.
Well, I don't know. You all probably disagree. I well, we think you're all gifted, so I think. We'll But I understand totally where you're coming from.
Yeah.
And I think that you're disciplined in tapping into the ethic early on. You know, there's, it's sort of everybody has a great story in them, but only 5% are going to sit down and bang it out and do all of that.
Yeah.
So the majority of the songs...
But I will admit I'm pretty good at it.
What's that? You are. I agree. Do we all agree? I mean, I think... And you've been really good at it for a long time, which is...
I've been doing it for a long time. Yeah. And you mentioned about the first songs and kind of looking back at things. Yeah, you know, when I look at some of the early songs, it's kind of like looking at your high school annual. You know, you're looking at that, man, look at those ears.
What was I wearing?
Look at that hood, that haircut.
Yeah.
And so there's some of that, you know, I look at some early songs and I would never redo anything. And because of the fact that we work the way we do, there's no area, no nuance of second guessing.
Right.
You can't second guess nothing. You just put it down and it feels right and it's right. You know, when we're in the studio, I'll change something, you know, only so it can be sung a little better. Or maybe I'll say, David, what do you think about this line here? I was thinking, here's an alternate line. You know, I like this one better. And that's it. But once that's done, it's done. It's not like I heard Leonard Cohen takes a year to write a song. Boy,
that's.
I can't even imagine that. If I had a year to write a song, I would just drive myself nuts.
Right.
Because and as it is, I do look at all the us and all the articles and the and the way a vowel kind of ends at the end of a phrase and opposed to a consonant and all, you know, and I do get real busy about the way I craft things. But given a year, I mean, take up a hot mommy or something.
Well, and I think you'd be in such a different place, too. There's something about the immediacy of your work and the immediacy of, I think, a lot of great songwriting is that it is about a moment in time.
Well, I think Hank Williams said if it takes you longer than 30 minutes, it's not worth a shit. But I have to respect that in a way because there's some songs that take longer than others. There are songs...
that take an hour.
Yeah, they write themselves.
Right.
And then that's when you know that you've tapped into something and that you kind of become kind of a conduit and the stuff kind of streams and pours through and then it kind of writes itself. Then the other ones are like, you know, you've got this huge block of marble and a chisel and a hammer and you're just like whacking away at the thing and waiting for something to reveal itself. And I personally can see those when I kind of look at a group of songs, I can tell the ones that I spend a lot of time with, because a lot of they feel just a little bit static to me. Where the other songs that seem to write themselves, they're just organic flow about it, and it's probably just things that I recognize. And then when if I'm working on melody and lyrics and David delivers a piece of music and I'm just like knocked out by it, it kind of freaks me out. Because I say, wow, I gotta make this great. How am I gonna do this? And that's when I start loading the dishwasher.
Right.
Because that's one thing, you know, like, when I have to sit down and work, I make any kind of excuse not to. And really, that's absolute truth with a lot of artists. To get to the point where they're actually going to sit down to work, to kind of face that blank canvas, you know, it's really menacing. And you go off and you water the lawn at 2 o'clock in the morning, that kind of thing. You know? And then you finally get to work, and it takes you go through this ritualistic thing where you sit down and get to work. Because remember, as artists, we create something out of nothing. And that's a crazy proposition.
Right.
Like if you're a carpenter, you got nails, you got wood. You know, if you're a mason, you've got brick, you got mortar. We have nothing. Artists don't have anything at all. You know, they have to create this stuff out of thin air. And that is absolutely crazy when you think about it. It's insane what we do. And it's not unusual to have a lot of crazy artists out there, I guess.
Sure. Now, with the new record and the new songs, anything that just sort of blew you away that just showed up like that? And
yeah, there was a couple of them that wrote themselves, yeah. And there was a couple of them that I kept pushing aside, because I was kind of feeling a little intimidated by them. and then I tried a couple things, and no, that's not working. And I go back to something else. And then there was the songs that just kind of, they happened. And really, I have to stress, you have to get inside of this sphere. You know, you've got a crack, and then you're inside of it. And then once you're inside, you know, and you're writing, and you're creating this thing, there's no time. There's no hands on the clock. There isn't anything. All of a sudden, you're looking, it's, wow, it's 4 a.m. And you don't realize what's been going on for the past 4 hours. You're just so involved in that. And then the flip side of that is that once you're on the inside and you're all done, you're kind of fighting desperately to get back out.
Right.
You know, and I'm still suffering from a little bit of post-traumatic record syndrome right now. Because it's, you know, you finish all this stuff, and as quickly as we do it, and because we don't really live with these songs, I hear about bands writing songs and taking them out on the road to work them out. What's that, you know? So the way because we write so quickly and so feverishly, and it just kind of pours out, and there's this emotional component that's really fatiguing, that once it's all done, it's like, you know, the first words out of my mouth and it goes through my head is like, what the hell was that all about?
Wow.
Because it's just, yeah, and you just got to get over it.
Okay, so then you send it out, and so now the record's out, it's being mixed, right?
Yeah.
And being done for... Release.
Yeah, we're still trying to find somebody to mix, you know, because we were going to have Chad Blake do it in Wales, but it just didn't work. So we're looking at a couple other people. That's a guy that does Neil Young and a couple other things. But we're getting close, but we have to get this thing done by June 1st so we can have a fall release. But yeah, it's all done. Yeah, as far as, you know, you let it, like you say, you just let it out into the world, just like a painter. You do painting, and the gallerist comes and takes it away, and off it goes and has a life of its own.
If you haven't seen the artwork in that kind of plug, because I don't know if Wayne and David, they're coming tonight. I don't know if they're here now, but they're going to be here tonight. The artists will be in the house. So I don't know where we're at time-wise, but I know I wanted to give some time for questions. So do we have any questions?
You know, curious, Wayne and David?
Yeah.
Wayne and David Bodea?
Yeah.
Oh, man, they're good buddies.
I know.
They have pieces.
Yeah, on the lobby. You haven't been out there yet.
To the movie La Bamba. So we were in the studio recording La Bamba at the same time as we were recording By the Light of the Moon. We had locked out Sunset Sound. We had two studios going. And so we put out By the Light of the Moon, came out in late spring, and summer, like June, La Bamba came out, and it was just like, you did just skyrocket. We didn't even expect it to be the worldwide hit. So it kind of eclipsed everything that happened before that. By the Light of the Moon, it was just like, it can just kind of disappear. So we're having maybe a little bit of an identity crisis, because like the very next record that we're, okay, what are we going to do for the next record? And so we, our answer to that was to create, do La Pistola y el Corazón, which is a collection of Mexican music, which critics from coast to coast all concluded that Los Lobos had committed commercial suicide. Because, I don't know, something told us we had to kind of throw a wrench in the machine.
Sure.
And it won a Grammy anyway, so I guess it was too
bad. It's a great record.
So after we got that done, and then we did this big rock record that was called The Neighborhood, and we got that, the big rock record, and we kind of got it out of our system, and then it was kind of clean slate. Identity crisis about who we are and all this stuff, you know, okay, we're all right. And then it was wide open. Then we met Mitchell Froom and Chad Blake, who had we're going through a similar kind of situation with Crowded House, huge hit. So we're all in the room together, and we decided we're going to make this record. So we just said, none of this stuff matters anymore. No formula, no nothing, let's just go in. And we went in, and when we went out, we had Kiko under our arm. And that's how that happened. It just, and then it became something that a lot of people were saying, like, what is this? You know, this isn't...
The album still blows me away. I mean, it did, the day it came out, and it still does. It's just amazing.
It blew our mind. We finished the record, we went to Ocean Way to listen to it all together. And Chad, myself, and the rest of the band, Mitchell, we all went into the studio, and they brought the lights down, and kind of sat back, and we listened to the record from the beginning to the end. When the record was over, nobody said anything. They just got up, got into their cars, and drove home. It was just like, wow. You know, if you're wondering, like, you know, what the heck is all this about? That was certainly, you know, a good example of that.
Yeah, incredible work. Any other questions? Hey.
It was made by Candelario Delgado, Candela's Guitars. He built that one for me. It's not a traditionally made one. It's actually put together like a tarp, sides, back, top, all this. The traditional ones are carved out of one piece of mahogany, believe it or not. Everything is one piece of mahogany, except for the top is the only separate piece. But Candelario built that one for me. The one I'm playing tonight up there was made by his uncle, probably in the 60s. I kind of saved that from the dumpster one day. And I had it was at a Quinto Jarocho, and I had it made into a jarana by Tomás Delgado, Candelario's son. And since then, I've got a traditional made one that was built by César Castro, Comalacha.
Oh, yeah.
He's incredible. He's from Veracruz. He knows exactly what to do. Look it up online. It's a beautiful instrument. But that one's in Minnesota right now. And my other one, the Candelario dude, is in Rocket Cargo, going on its way to Texas for this weekend's gig. So that one's at home, so here it is.
Yeah, and if you're looking to buy one, Cesar's the guy to go to, yeah. And he does sell them and all of that.
One day, late for rehearsal, I became the drummer. And for about 10 years. And then when I decided I wanted to go back to playing guitar, I showed Birdie. I plugged in the guitar and said, I'm not going anywhere. But the jarana is my best friend. Jarana, man, let me tell you, it's never let me down. It's part of me. I've been playing jarana for a long time. And then when I sat down with César Castro, when he made the one for me, I went over to his house, and I said, wow, cool. He says, play it so I can hear it from this side. And then he played, and I just said, oh my God. You know, I thought I knew how to play this thing. This guy was just incredible. So I need to take lessons. There's this whole Jaranero movement, you know about that, right? It's everywhere. Santana has a really big deal. LA's got a big deal. It's crazy. It's I never in my wildest dreams or imagination would expect to see a 15-year-old girl on the way to school with a jarana on her back. It's just a really, really great thing that's going on.
And you've done some work with getting them into the schools, right?
Yeah, I did a little bit of that. I got some guitars for this school in Highland Park, and I'm doing more service. Well, look, I'm 62. I want to go to heaven now. So I do service. My whole family always did. You know, my mom always fed everybody. You know, I would go home. There's always somebody on the porch eating a plate of food, and my sister, who's a little older than I, was always kind of an activist and always, you know, doing stuff. And it's just kind of in the blood. So, you know, we want to help people out. Not because we want to go to heaven, you know. That's
what you do.
We do.
That's very cool. So I got a question there, and then I'm going to give Sid one more chance to see if that question has materialized.
Sid, you should sit down.
Okay, go ahead.
Louie, I read when you were young that the turning point of your life was when your mom let you go see Hendrix.
Oh, yeah, absolutely.
Does you still find influence through him, or?
Oh, yeah. I mean, I won't play any of his music. you know, because I just kind of just like, come on, there's all these people, you know, try to, you know, now, there's just, there was nobody else like him, you know. I was 14 years old, I had Are You Experienced, and I was completely blown away by it. Then he was going to be playing at the Hollywood Bowl, and I begged my mom, I need to go. So she got a family friend, who's this old guy, who was 18, chaperoned me, bought him a ticket, bought me a ticket, and we went to the Hollywood Bowl. And I had a, I'm going to really date myself. I was wearing a white Penny's Towncraft t-shirt with an army jacket that was perfectly pressed, a Catholic boy's haircut, and one little string of beads. So I was a hip dude. And Jimi Hendrix came out and opened with Spanish Castle Magic, and it just, that was it. Every cell in my body was rearranged. At that point, I just knew that I wanted to do something. I'm certainly not going to be able to do that, but I knew that I was in then.
It was interesting when Louie and I talked, probably our first phone conversation, we talked for quite a while, and that was one of the things that came up. And it's interesting to me, with all the artists that I've met and talked to of different nationalities that play different styles. I think Dave Alvin talked about it. Some of the Hawaiian artists who we talked about it. It's amazing how many of them, Hendrix is the touchstone. It's just something magical there.
27 years old when he died?
27 years old.
Yeah. I was still, you know, kicking a can on the street when I was 27 years old.
Heartbreaking.
Yeah.
Heartbreaking. Yeah.
See
it. Sid, did it come to you?
It was the flip side of I Second That Emotion.
What is the flip side?
You Must Be Love.
Oh. I must be.
Oh, no. That was the name of the song, sorry.
I don't know, that one goes
it is
beautiful.
Well, I remember the chorus had this incredible chorus. It said, love couldn't possibly be. Love could possibly be anything that you're not. And it goes through this whole list of things that it was just incredible. And then it teared me up. There was another song, though, too, that my mom used to play. It was a song by Jose Alfredo Jimenez that was sung in Spanish. And, you know, I learned how to speak Spanish really young because we live with my grandma. My mom didn't speak Spanish at home. But there was a song that as a matter of fact, I'm going to do tonight that made me cry. About a little bird who, there's all this, you know, kind of, the Mexican music, traditional Mexican music always had like these animals kind of taking the place of real people, you know. And this song is called Gorrioncillo Pecho Amarillo, which means a little bird with a yellow breast. And that song is, about the little bird, you know, crying in the night, singing because it's lost its love. It's just beautiful. I mean, it's just so beautiful, the metaphors and this anthropomorphic thing with animals and stuff, so, yeah. But You Must Be Loved, that was the first thing that came across my mind, right? You special. Who didn't do that tonight?
Well, listen, I want to thank everybody for being here. I want to be, well, respectful of Louie's time.